There are times in life when the barrier between the spiritual realm and the physical world becomes thin, when the veil is lighter and we feel more connected. These are sacred times. Sometimes they come without warning. Sometimes we can prepare ourselves to be more open, and then we're able to sense our deep, deep connection with God, the great cloud of witnesses, and with each other. For Jesus, his baptism was one of those times. It's unclear from the gospel accounts whether the voice proclaiming Jesus was the beloved was heard by everybody or just by Jesus. In our reading for today, it says there was a voice, but not who heard. It says the voice came while he was praying, so from that, it could have been a prayer response, or it could have been a general response to everyone in the area. In Matthew's and Mark's accounts, the authors tell us that Jesus heard a voice from heaven. Again, that doesn't mean only Jesus, but it might imply that. The Gospel of John has a narrative from John describing seeing the Spirit descend on Jesus like a dove, and then John declared that Jesus is the Messiah, the Lamb of God. Regardless of whether the voice was heard by everyone or whether only Jesus heard it, the moment was meaningful enough for the story to be remembered and shared, just like we share our significant events with others. Our reading begins by telling us that the people were filled with expectation and they were questioning in their hearts. In other words, they were ready to experience the holy. They were open, they were focused, they were engaged, and they were expecting God to reveal truth to them. I think that's a big key for being able to hear and fully witness those sacred times in our lives. That element of being open combined with expectation heightens our awareness and helps us to recognize things we might not otherwise notice. Sharing stories of encounters with God helps us to become even more open, more willing to anticipate God's actions and presence with us. It's like exercising our spiritual selves. The more we experience, the more we're able to experience. If I wanted to become a good basketball player, I wouldn't expect to develop my skills by pulling weeds in my flower gardens. I'd study the sport, I'd practice the game until my skills developed, then I would continue to work on improving those skills. If I wanted to be a great cook, I wouldn't go about achieving that goal by playing soccer. I'd talk to people about how they fix their specialties, I'd study, I would practice cooking, and I would expose myself to lots of good food cooked by others to get inspiration for my own recipes. Our faith works the same way. If we want to feel close to God, if we want to feel like we have a good connection when we pray, if we want to be aware of God's presence and guidance with us throughout our lives, we need to become filled with expectation. And we need to practice recognizing God. We develop those skills of expectation and openness by listening to the stories in our scriptures, the stories of our friends, by paying attention, and by listening to our own experiences. Times like Christmas, Easter, baptisms, weddings, and deaths can help us to develop an awareness of the Spirit acting in special ways so that we're more ready to recognize that different feeling at other times too. It's easier to talk about that closeness with the Holy Spirit during happy times like baptism and special holidays, but I think we can find the presence of the Holy Spirit more profoundly at some of those less wonderful times in our lives. And then once we feel our connection, those less than wonderful times can become so wondrous. It's not easy having a loved one approaching death. It's hard to watch them become progressively sicker, progressively weaker. It's hard to cope with the uncertainty of life without them. But if we allow ourselves to be open to God's presence in the midst of our pain and fear and uncertainty, those last months or weeks or days or even hours can contain very holy times for us and our loved one. One of the jobs of the church as the body of believers, and one of the jobs of each of us as part of that body, is to learn to be filled with expectation. Just like Michael Jordan, or Muhammad Ali, or Calvin Johnson, or Al Kaline, or Pavel Datsyuk, or Serena Williams becoming proficient in their chosen sports, we can't develop skills of being people of faith without lots and lots of practice. If they had each shown up once a week for a couple hours, none of them would have ever become any good at their sport. Sunday morning worship is important for us, but it's not enough. We need to be watching and listening and sharing stories all week. Many of us start our stories about special encounters with something like, this is going to sound crazy, but, or, don't think I'm crazy, but, as people of faith, we should be telling those stories with confidence and excitement. Not apologetically, with fear of judgment or rejection. We should be as comfortable talking about the holy as we are talking about any other aspect of our lives. It should be as easy for me to say to anyone that I saw God at the bookstore yesterday when my precious Aiden was able to switch from being stuck in an autistic loop of anger back to his sweet, joyful self. As easy it is for me to say that I went to a bookstore. And I should be more excited to tell you about that miraculous change in precious Aiden than I am to tell you I found the most awesome book to use to explain Passover to kids. And I should be even more excited about that book because I realized it jumped out at me before I was even looking for books. I was scanning the store to see what departments are where and trying to decide what department to go to when all of a sudden this book caught my eye and I read it and it's great. What a God moment. Two encounters within minutes of each other on a Saturday afternoon in a bookstore. Are you familiar with Alice in Wonderland? There's a great sub-story. Alice talks about her father who taught her to imagine impossible things. She said sometimes she would think of six impossible things before breakfast. When she was called upon to be the champion to fight the Jabberwocky, she was of course terrified. But the way she found her composure and the way she found the strength to be able to defeat that horrible menace was to list five impossible things that had already happened that day, and then to claim her sixth impossible thing that would happen as her defeating the Jabberwocky. And it worked. She filled herself with expectation by practicing impossibilities, and the impossibilities became possible. We can do that with our relationship with God. If we take a cue from those seekers who were gathered around John the Baptist and then became followers of Jesus, we can become filled with expectation. Even a tiny amount is enough to open our eyes to God's presence. And once we start seeing God in momentary bits, we'll start noticing God more and more. I either had an inconvenient conglomeration of coincidences or a divine intervention at my office that started last week and became fully visible this week. I was alone in the office and decided I wanted to heat some water to make some tea. We have a room, a small room or a large closet that has a little refrigerator and a microwave and a coffee pot, all plugged into a single power strip. I know, not a good idea, but we've never had a problem before. And I went back there and the coffee pot wouldn't turn on to heat my water. And then I noticed the light, the clock wasn't on the microwave. So I looked for the power strip to see if it had tripped itself. Somehow, that power strip cord was wrapped and wrapped and wrapped around a snow shovel handle that was stuck between the refrigerator and the wall. So I couldn't pull the cord out to get a good look. So I reached in and felt for the switch and tripped it again, and nothing happened. So I thought, oh, I must have blown a fuse. Well, there's a circuit panel in there, and I turned to look at it, and everything said on. But one circuit, it's a push button kind, the button wasn't quite as far depressed as the others. And I thought, oh, this must be it. It just didn't pop all the way out. So I pushed it to turn it all the way off. I pushed it again, and it didn't budge. And I tried, and I tried, and I tried, and it wouldn't budge. So I thought, well, I might as well clear up this table mess over here because I'm going to have to call somebody to work on it. But when I got that power strip untangled, which who knows how that could happen, because the only person who uses that snow shovel is me, and I certainly didn't stand there and wrap a cord around it. There was a reset button on the end of the power strip. Pushed the button, the clock turned on. So, two completely unrelated electrical problems in this much space, and I got to make my coffee. Actually, my tea, I was heating water, not making coffee. So I texted Doug and Amelia, the two massage therapists that were not there at the time, told them what had happened, said, I don't know what's not working because everything seems fine, maybe it's an extra circuit. Well, Deb was off sick for a few days, and when she came in on Monday, she said, half my room has no power. So we now knew what the circuit went to, and I told her the story again because she wasn't feeling good, so she didn't remember what I'd said. She went back there and she pushed and pushed and pushed, and it didn't budge. And so we made a horrible maze of extension cords and power strips to get her up and running, and contacted Amelia's husband, Drew, who's an electrician, and he would come the next day and fix it. Took care of it just fine, replaced the faulty circuit, everything's great. But it was a God encounter. Deb has a son-in-law who's also an electrician, and when she told him about it, he said, huh, that's really strange. They quit using that style of circuit breaker because they don't work, they don't pop, they start fires. So, either it was the strangest set of circumstances, or God. I told Drew about that, and he said, oh yeah, I didn't think about that. John's right. We don't use those because they're fire hazards. They don't pop like they're supposed to. You're right, God. That's the official vote of the electrician, God. It could be just another day. It could just be a bunch of inconvenience, or it could be we were kept safe because we never would have noticed that faulty circuit breaker if I'd been able to heat water. We need to share these stories. We need to be open to recognizing them. We need to claim them for what they are, many miracles happening every day in our lives. We need to be people of expectation. May we all be filled with expectation like those first people in early Palestine. Amen.